Okay, so now we're happy to have Carolyn Turnage-Butterbaugh speaking about moments of zeta and the vertical distribution of its zeros.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate the opportunity to try out this sort of setup. I've never given a virtual talk before. So you can see from my window, it's actually sunny in Northfield, Minnesota today, which is unusual. So happy to be here. So today what I'm going to talk about really concerns lots of open conjectures in number theory that come from if we start thinking about the vertical distribution of the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And we'll see how this problem touches into lots of different areas of number theory where there are a lot of open questions that we're still working towards. So let's just start at the very beginning. And let's start off by making sure we're all on the same page. So as Riemann did, we will let S equals sigma plus IT denote a complex number. And the Riemann zeta function can be given as a Dirichlet series as well as an Euler product as long as the real part of S is greater than one. And so Riemann was able to prove some analytic properties about the zeta function. And so I want to just quickly go over those. So the first is that the zeta function has meromorphic continuation to the complex plane. There's only one problem spot, and that's that S is equal to 1, where there's a simple pole of residue 1. And so in particular, that means that if you consider zeta of S minus 1 over S minus 1, you have an entire function. Okay, let's see how this works. We also know that the zeta function has a functional equation. So this allows us to compare values of zeta of S with values of zeta of 1 minus S. And one way to write down that functional equation, you have a few options because the gamma function is involved. But one way to write them down is kind of in this simple asymmetric form that I have here. And so just what I want to point out is one really nice quick thing you can prove with the functional equation is that the zeta function has trivial zeros at the negative even integers. And you can see that by just plugging in S is equal to negative 2n into what I have just above. All right, so if we do that, then we say, well, I know this is not equal to 0. And the gamma function, this will just be 2n factorial, so that's not equal to 0. I know sine here is equal to 0. And because the zeta function converges when sigma is greater than 1, we also know in particular, it never equals 0 to the right of 1. And so there you go. We already have found infinitely many zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And so that's why we call these trivial. Once you know the functional equation, you're in business. Okay, so another thing to note is that the zeros are symmetric about the real axis. And this is because zeta of S is also written as, can be written as the conjugate of S of the conjugate of zeta of the conjugate of S. All right, so if we're going to collect all this information that we've just pointed out, we know that at S is equal to 1, we have a pole. We know that there are trivial zeros at the negative even integers. And then what we also know is that there are infinitely many zeros in this critical strip that we have here. And in particular, we know that the first zero, if you look on the upper half plane, happens just a little bit above 14. And because by symmetry, we also have one down below at negative 14.1. And then in particular, if I were to have any other zeros, say a zero right here, then by all the symmetry that I have, I would get three others. So once we know one, we'd actually get three more. And because of the, in the proof of the prime number, prime number theorem, you find out that a better zero-free region for the zeros of the zeta function would correspond to a better error term in the prime number theorem. And this is where the Riemann hypothesis comes from. The statement that all non-trivial zeros of the zeta function have real part equal to a half, so that they're in fact on this critical line. All right, so the zeta function is our object of study. And what we want to think about is, first of all, just these zeros that live in the critical strip. So so all of this is classical. If you want to count the number of zeros that live between, whose real part is between 0 and 1, and whose imaginary part is up to some height t, we might as well just look in the upper half plane because of the symmetry. And you can do an argument principle calculation to write down a rather precise definite formula for the number of zeros that you have in this setting. So for example, the main term here is what you really want to look at, but it's pretty nice to see that we also have some other pieces. This S of t here, this is the argument of the zeta function. And by the late 1800s, it was already known that this was at least bounded above by log of t. So we don't have to worry about that competing with our main term. And so in particular, what I want to point out here, though, is that what this main term tells us then is how to think about the average gap between two consecutive zeros of the zeta function. So if I have two consecutive zeros that live somewhere in this box or anywhere in the critical strip, then the average gap between gamma sub n, that's the imaginary ordinate of the zero, and the next one, which I'll call gamma m sub 1, is asymptotic to, say, 2 pi over log of gamma sub n. All right, so that's our starting point. That's the average spacing between the gaps. And so now we want to ask questions about, well, how often are there zeros that are further apart than on average or closer together? And then what I'm going to try to do in this talk is show you why asking that question is interesting, in my opinion, and the other little areas of number theory that this touches. Okay, so to set up the problem, we're going to consider the ordinates of zeros on the upper half plane. And one thing that I want to point out here is that I'm not assuming anything about simplicity of the zeros. So that's another open problem to show that the zeros of the zeta function are in fact simple. But I'm not assuming that here. I'm just going to, if they repeat, then they repeat, and that's okay. And so the thing to note is that now if I normalize by the space between a zero and its next nearest neighbor, then this should be one on average. And so kind of the driving question for today's talk is to say, what can we say about small gaps and what can we say about large gaps? So I'll use the notation mu to pick out small gaps. And again, these are normalized relative to the average spacing. And I'll use lambda to look for, oh, that wasn't supposed to happen. Sorry. I'll use lambda to search out large gaps. Okay. Now, the first thing to note is that we can say a little bit. By definition, we know that mu is at most 1 and lambda is at least 1. All right. And it wasn't until the 1940s that the observation was made that mu is strictly less than 1 and lambda is strictly greater than 1. So I have Selberg listed here and Fuji listed here. That's because Selberg observed this phenomenon. No proof was given. Fuji also mentioned it in one of his papers. If you'd like to see a proof of this result, then where you want to go is Heath Brown's edition of Titchmarsh. This is found in like the end of chapter 9, I believe. And so Heath Brown there actually sketches out how you would be able to observe such a strict inequality. He uses mean values of the argument of the zeta function that were done by Fuji. And one thing that's really nice about Heath Brown's proof of this statement is that it's unconditional and it holds for a positive proportion of zeros. So we'll kind of compare that kind of result to other results in a little bit. But if you're kind of interested to see where this is worked out, then Titchmarsh is your place to go. All right, so what's the conjecture? This is a lecture on conjectures. The conjecture is that the small gap mu should actually be equal to 0, and that the large gap parameter lambda should be as big as you want, should be infinity. And so the way to say this in words is to say, we think that there are infinitely many pairs of zeros of zeta that are arbitrarily close or far apart relative to the average spacing. And what I'd like to do is, before I talk to you about the progress that has been made towards these conjectures, I want to give a feeling for where these conjectures even come from. All right, so we can see the small gaps conjecture coming from another famous conjecture, Montgomery's pair correlation conjecture. So I want to point out a few things here in this blue box that are shown out. So here, what you want to keep your eye on is this parameter C and where it shows up. All right, so what's happening in the sum is we're taking a sum over zeros of the zeta function up to height t, and we're wanting to see if their gap is in between 0 and 2 pi c over log t. And then what's out in front here is just a normalization for the number of t's that we have. So we're really looking at this average. And the observation to make here is that, so Montgomery's conjecture is that this sum should be asymptotic to what's on the right-hand side here. And the thing to note is that what's on the right-hand side is always bigger than zero and less than c, all right? So the idea then is that you should be able to make c as small as you want and still get some sort of contribution to this counting of numbers that are close together. As soon as you have something, well, what we're counting on the left-hand side is discrete, so you at least have a pair that would satisfy the condition. So the pair correlation conjecture, if it was true, and that's a big conjecture in of its on itself, would in particular imply that mu is equal to zero. Okay, so that's one place that this comes from. We're also going to talk about a few other places where, well, why was Montgomery even thinking about making a pair correlation conjecture? That's going to show up as well. Now, for large gaps, we can also get a hint from Montgomery's pair correlation conjecture. Here, what he's conjecturing is that the pair correlation function of zeros of the zeta function is this piece that I've got right here. And you know, the great tale of why you should always go to t when you're at work is because this was the situation where Montgomery and Dyson realized they were studying two very similar looking things from very different points of view. And so in particular, Dyson noted that eigenvalues of random Hermitian matrices have the same pair correlation function. So again, it's a conjecture for the zeta function that this is its pair correlation function for the zeros. But it's known that this is the pair correlation function for eigenvalues of these types of matrices. If you want to see some numerical data, a lot has been done confirm in a numerically by Lischko. And so further observations in this realm, if you hop over to the side of random matrix theory and what you know there, you can develop the conjecture that lambda is equal to infinity. All right, so where are we right now? Our conjectures are that we should have infinitely many pairs of zeros that are closer together, or as close together as we want relative to the average spacing. And we should likewise have infinitely many that are as far apart as we want relative to the average spacing. All right, so what I'll do right now is I'll stop and say, are there any questions so far? And if so, now's a good time to ask, and otherwise I'll just keep going.
We have a question here.
Okay, great.
I don't know if I can formulate an appropriate question without having this tied up.
One moment. So could you hear that question from our microphone?
I couldn't. Could you repeat it?
Okay, could you move a little closer?
It's not important.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm going to do?
So, yeah, you just need to go closer to the mic so it picks you up.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
My name's Frederick. Hello.
Hi, Frederick.
Would you mind scrolling up, please?
Sure. Tell me when. There's a little bit of a lag, so.
Well, first of all, is that a summation?
It is a summation.
Okay. And then could you scroll up some more, please?
Sure.
Okay, continue.
Okay. Even more.
Is that Heath or Keith? Heath?
I'm sorry, I don't understand the question.
I needed to revisit the slides before deciding whether or not I can pose a viable question.
Oh, I understand. Okay.
Would you mind explaining the argument principle to me?
Sure. So what I'll say here is that the argument principle is something in a complex analysis class that maybe if you're lucky, depending on how fast your professor goes, you get it towards the end of the term. So what it does is it helps you count zeros and poles within a certain region. So what I'll say is that this is an involved calculation. But it's actually pretty, it's standard in the sense that I'd be happy to share with you a reference where you could look up what's going on. But this is a technique from complex analysis.
Can you use the argument principle to demonstrate that the function has no zeros?
In certain situations, that might be the case. That's right.
Okay.
Any other questions? Yeah, you're welcome. Any other questions? Okay, so let's scroll down. And what I'd like to get at first is where we are in our quest to prove these conjectures, okay? So keep in mind that at least by Heath Brown, we know that mu is at most one, all right? So we know that. But also we have this following collection of current records. And so what I'd like to point out is the following. So what I have above this line here are techniques where we are assuming the Riemann hypothesis. And so hopefully you can see there in all of these cases, we're assuming the Riemann hypothesis. And what's above the line are numbers that don't look as small, but the thing to point out about all of these is that these hold for a positive proportion of zeros. And the technique that's used here is based off of Montgomery's pair correlation theorem. So what you know towards the pair correlation, assuming the Riemann hypothesis, these types of results can be pulled out. Now, if you look below the dotted line, then we have some numbers that if I told you just like the best result all at once, you might say, okay, that's pretty good. But and if you look at the history of the problem, you can see that there's something going on, it seems, with this half. In particular, I want to know, though, I want to point out that what's below the dotted line are using a different method, and that method we're going to talk about today. But as of today, the world record for small gaps is that mu is at most 0.515396. And again, this is also under the Riemann hypothesis, but now we just know this holds for infinitely many zeros. Right now you might say, why does that matter? Well, we're gonna see in a little bit where this connects to another theorem. Okay, so it seems like something's going on with a half here. This is a lot of work over many years to make improvements. And so kind of the question is kind of what's going on? Why is this one half kind of seeming like it's fighting back to us? All right, so the reason why, one of the reasons why, is because there is a connection to this problem with the class number problem and the hypothetical counterexamples to the Riemann hypothesis for Dirichlet-Yale functions. All right, so let's just kind of state this problem and kind of see how the zeros of the zeta function are kind of influencing what's going on here. So if we start with a negative fundamental discriminant, then we can build the quadratic imaginary quadratic field, and we can define the ideal class group of K of this quadratic field as the group of fractional ideals modded out by the subgroup of principal ideals. And so this is some finite abelian group, and so it has a size, and we call that size the class number. Okay, so if you've seen this before, great. If you haven't, let me just point out that one reason that you might want to know this number is for what I've got on the bottom of the screen. Suppose that the class number is one. Well, that means that your class group is trivial, but that means that the ring of integers of K is a principal ideal domain. And then in this case, that actually is equivalent to being a unique factorization domain. So you get the other inclusion because the ring of integers is a Dedekind domain. So understanding the size of the class number, in a sense, can give you a understanding of how far off your favorite field is from having unique factorization, very loosely speaking. So Gauss conjectured that the class number goes to infinity as D runs through all the negative discriminants, and this was proven by Heilbronn in 1934. And so in particular, that means that there are only finitely many imaginary fields, quadratic fields, with a fixed class number. And so the question is, well, okay, if I fix a class number, can you just tell me all the fundamental discriminants that would return a ring of integers who has this particular class number? This is the class number problem. And it's not highlighted in blue because it is solved, all right? So let's just point out that the n equals one case was solved by Starr, Kegner, and Baker. And here we have the list of discriminants where the class number is equal to one. And then you might say, well, what about if n is greater than one? What do we know then? All right, so here is where things get really interesting, in my opinion, because, so what I've written down is the class number formula. I've just gone ahead and assumed that the fundamental discriminant is less than four so that we can write down a really nice kind of clean version of the theorem, of the formula. And here, what I want to point out is we have a Dirichlet L function, and the character that's put in, this is the Kronecker symbol. And the idea is that if we're going to be able to produce lists of discriminants that have a fixed class number, then we need to be able to at least get a lower bound on the class number so that we can have an algorithm that is tractable. So the first thing I want to point out is at least we know that the class number is at least one. It's a finite abelian group. It's at least got the identity in it. And so by the class number formula, at the same time, I can also at least then get a lower bound on the L function. Now, if you assume the Riemann hypothesis, then you can get a lower bound on the Dirichlet L function at the number one. And so then that would also give you a lower bound on the class number. And so what we would like is to be able to get a stronger unconditional lower bound on the L function, and then in turn be able to get a lower bound on the class number. And here's where things get really cool, in my opinion. The difficulty is that the Dirichlet L function could have an exceptional zero. And these exceptional zeros, we know a lot about them, even though we don't know if they exist or not. We know that if they exist, it's a real simple zero lying very close to one. And if it's very close to one, it makes it really hard to get a lower bound on the L function at one. And if that's a problem, then using the class number formula, it's also hard to get a lower bound on the class group itself, the size of the class group itself. All right, so these exceptional zeros are called Landau-Ziegel zeros, and they're a part of what's making this a difficult problem. So really now we have like two goals. One goal is to say, well, can I solve the class number problem, getting a good enough unconditional lower bound on H of K? And then kind of a new problem that's revealed itself is, can we get a strong enough unconditional lower bound on the L function so that we know there aren't any of these exceptional zeros? All right, so by a continuity argument, if the lower bound is strong enough, then we would eliminate the possibility of such a zero. All right, so the first goal, Siegel in 1935 gave a lower bound on the class number, but unfortunately the implied constant is not computable. But then the class number problem was solved by the combined work of Goldfeld and Gross-Zaghier by giving a strong enough lower bound on the class number. And so what this does is it allows one in principle to solve the class number problem for any fixed H. And in particular, using this lower bound in 2004, Watkins actually computed complete lists of the fundamental discriminants for fixed class numbers up to 100. All right, so we can get a lower bound on H of K, but in turn, this doesn't give us a lower bound on the L function in order to just at least get rid of the idea of these possible exceptional zeros. And so this is now where the spacing problem for the zeros of the zeta function comes into play. So this is a version of a theorem that's written in a 2002 paper by Connery and Avanians. And this is what it says. It says for all large t, there are more than t log t to the 4/5 non-trivial zeros of the zeta function, such that their normalized spacing is basically a little bit less than a half. Then you would get a much stronger lower bound on the Dirichlet-Yau function. So here I'm saying, so what Connery and Avanians are saying is that if you know something about spacings of zeros about the Riemann zeta function, it tells you about something about the L function for a Dirichlet character. And what's really nice here too is that the implied constant is computable. So this theorem is stated well at the end of their very, very large paper. So we're just kind of going to take this as the black box. But what this is kind of pointing out for us is the following. In the previous slides up above, where we had this one half seeming like it was fighting back, one explanation for why that one half is fighting back is because by this result of Connery and Avanias, if you were to beat the one half barrier unconditionally and for lots and lots of zeros, then you would be able to conclude that there aren't any Landau-Ziegler zeros. And that's a really big statement, right? So it seems there's a reason why, at least in this sense, this one half is starting, is becoming very, very difficult for anyone to achieve, despite the fact in that theorem, they're assuming the Riemann hypothesis and not trying to solve the problem for lots and lots of zeros, just like infinitely many. So now we see that the spacing of the zeros is related to the class number problem. Indeed, it was Montgomery who was investigating this connection when he worked on the paracorrelation conjectures. And then this was carefully written down in 2002 by Connery and Avanias to really display quantitatively what you would have to prove in order to get this result. So all of this is tangled up together, Landau-Ziegler zeros, class number problem, zeros of the zeta function, and so forth. All right, so again, let me just remind you, this is the small gaps progress that we have. And again, it seems like this one half is fighting back, right? Of course, you might say, well, I'm a whole hundredth away from a half. Maybe I could do a little bit better than that. And we'll talk about that a little bit as well. Okay, so what I'd like to do is take a little moment to tell you the way that people are approaching these small gaps results. So this is kind of like the state-of-the-art approach. And again, what we really want is we want a result that's unconditional and holds for many, many zeros of the zeta function. But for the moment, we're saying, okay, we'll assume the Riemann hypothesis, we'll be fine with just getting infinitely many zeros, then what can we do? So this approach was actually first developed by Julia Mueller in the early 80s in the context of large gaps. And in 84, it was determined to also apply to small gaps by Connery, Ghosh, and Gonick. And around the same time, Montgomery and Nedlishko had an equivalent method, but the presentation by Connery, Ghosh, and Gonick is much simpler, and so I'm going to follow that approach. So here's the setup, and we'll talk a little bit about what's going on here. So the idea is that you start with a Dirichlet polynomial, and you're going to be able to choose for yourself what you want these coefficients to be, all right? So that's a choice that's going to have to be made. And then you're going to look at two different mean values. So one of the mean values, what I'll call M sub 1, I think the way to think about it is that it's like a global average of the series of the polynomial A sub T. And then M sub 2, I think more of this is like a local average near the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. All right, so we have the zeros here coming into play, and then we're seeing local around this little area, how is the function A of t behaving? All right, so the basic idea is that we're going to compare these mean values. We're going to have to choose a little a sub k, and I'm going to show you how this can reveal something about spacings of zeros. All right, so the way to do that is to first realize that this local average is monotonically increasing. So the thing just to look at here is here's C, here's C, here's C, and the integrand is positive, right? So as C gets bigger, I'm integrating something more that's positive. So this will be a monotonically increasing function. And then my other claim is that I can wedge in between here something that I'm very interested in. So remember, the mu is the parameter looking for small gaps. And the lambda was the parameter we set up at the beginning looking at large gaps. And we already know that mu is less than one is less than lambda, all right? So at least the endpoints here are set up in a way that seems reasonable. And now what we need to do is understand why M1 can be sitting right in here. So what I'm gonna give you is just like a hand-wavy heuristic for how this works. The idea is that I do know that the average spacing for any consecutive zeros or any zeros in this little interval is like 2 pi over log t. And so what that means in the range of integration is the following. So I've already put in some hypothetical zeros into the range of integration. And so the idea is that if C is less than one and I draw a little circles around little intervals around the zeros where these are now length 2 pi c over log t. If c is less than 1, then these should be smaller than the average spacing. And so the idea is that we don't really have much overlap, if any. Again, very hand-wavy, broad strokes kind of idea to think about it. But then the idea then is that this local average over the zeros should be less than or equal to what happens across the entire interval, right? And that's if C is less than one. And then what that means then is that, well, since mu is less than one, we know that M2 of mu is less than or equal to M1. Likewise, you can also use this for large gaps. So on the other hand, if C is greater than one, then you might put some bigger pieces around the zeros in the local averages. And so when you add them up, the issue is that maybe you'll have a little bit of extra overlap. And so in this case, the local average should be bigger than the global average because there's a little bit of overlap. Again, hand wavy, but this is the idea. But once you have this, this is the structure that you need because this is the setup that you have. If I have this length of this set of inequalities, then that means that if I can find a C that forces M2 to be smaller than M1, then because the sequence is monotonically increasing, it must be the case that lambda is greater than C. And on the other hand, if I can find a C that forces M2 of C to be bigger than M1, then again, I'll now get an upper bound on mu. So that's the idea. So what you have to do is you have to start off and say, I'm gonna build a Dirichlet polynomial. So there's a choice there. I have to pick what the coefficients are. And I need to find a C that makes this ratio bigger than one. And if I do that, I will have produced a lower bound or an upper bound of C for small gaps. And likewise, you can also use this for large gaps. And this is what Julia Mueller noticed. And then Conry Gosch-Ngonick realized you could also adapt it for small gaps. All right, so what we look at here is okay, so you start off with your series and you have a lot of Euler summation and things like that to do to get the formula, the ratio that you're interested in the following form. All right, so I will spare you the details of that, but it can be done. And since we want in small gaps for the ratio to be bigger than one, that means that I need to pick some polynomial that's really big around zeros of the zeta function, because I want the way that the top part behaves here to be a lot bigger. All right, so now you ask yourself, what's a function that's big around zeros of the zeta function? And you might say like 1/zeta is big around zeros of the zeta function. It's a little bit more helpful to put in a little extra piece here because then, so this is an overlap of notation. I apologize for that, but this is the Liouville function. And it's completely multiplicative, which is really helpful in a lot of the calculations. All right, so since zeta of 2s over zeta of s is big around zeros of the zeta function, what this leads us to do is to say, well, let me just truncate it into a series and choose that as my Dirichlet polynomial. All right, so once you make that choice, then you go back to your formulas and you put everything in. And again, I will spare you the details of that, but I want to give you a sense of how these calculations typically run. All right, so here's a nice cleaned up version of what you end up getting. That's not too bad. And then you open up Mathematica and you try to find a value of C that's bigger than zero that makes this piece here bigger than one. And if you can do that, then you'll get an upper bound for a small gap, is the way it works. So there's a lot of hitting shift enter and holding your breath, so to speak, and hoping that you get something that works. And it turns out that if you let C be equal to 0.5181, then you really do get the left-hand side of this inequality is greater than one. And so by the way that we set up, because of the set of that inequality where we have the function being monotonically increasing, that gives us an upper bound on mu. So now the question is, and the way the state of the art approaches have gone is, well, let me go back to that Dirichlet series and see, can I pick a better function that's big around zeros of the zeta function, right? And still be able to write down all the formulas and do all the calculations. So in particular, Connery and Ghosh and Gonick chose the original setup that I just presented before with another little multiplicative function. And what's nice here is that it introduces a new parameter. And so when you're optimizing, you also get to optimize over what this R is equal to. And this is how they produce their result. Again, all of this is under the Riemann hypothesis. The Riemann hypothesis is baked into this method. Now, the subsequent refinements of this approach have more or less looked like the following. So these are the choices for coefficients of the Dirichlet series. And here, so we have like the Connery-Ghosh-Gonick choice, but then we've also got some sort of smoothing function. And generally in practice, it ends up being a polynomial of really low degree that ends up being sufficient. And sometimes instead of one polynomial, we choose two polynomials and so forth. Okay, so these choices, and can I get a thumbs up or something? Everybody is frozen on my screen and I'm worried that I'm just talking to nobody.
Yeah, we can hear you, it's going great.
Okay, thanks. Everybody was frozen, I got nervous. Okay, thank you. Okay, so here, these are the subsequent refinements. And now we remember that there was this 1/2 problem that seems to arise from a really deep reason of possibility of Landau's equal zeros. And I'll just say, in addition to that, Connery, Ghosh, and Gonick actually show at the very end of their paper that this method will never produce anything less than 1/2. And it's a quick, simple argument. So I invite you, if you're curious, to see it. This is their 1984 paper. It's just a little argument at the very end, and you can see this limitation. I will point out that it's also been in unpublished notes, Dan Goldson has shown that you actually can't even hit 1/2 with this method. And so we do know that 1/2 is a barrier for deep reasons like Landau's equal zeros. And so the question is that what is influencing this method limitation, or is it just a coincidence that both of these have a limitation of 1/2? Okay, so we're not gonna beat 1/2 with this method. And it looks like by the a lot has been squeezed out of this method, and a lot of work has been done by picking out different values of f to get values that are just a little bit stronger. All right, so after this talk about small gaps, before we look into large gaps, I thought I would pause and see what questions we have. And again, everybody's frozen on my side, so maybe if in the chat window somebody could say it's all good, I'll keep going.
I think it looks good. It's very clear. Thank you.
Okay, great. Okay, so we've talked about small gaps, and we understand that the small gaps conjecture is related to two other very big open conjectures in analytic number theory. One is Montgomery's pair correlation conjecture, and the other is the existence or non-existence of Landau's equal zeros, which makes these problems difficult. That's why they're fighting back. But now what I'd like to do is show you how, if you instead think about the question of large gaps, how this problem also touches another big open problem in analytic number theory, and that has to do with the moments of the Riemann zeta function. So the previous method that I mentioned to you by Mueller is something that can be applied to get some bounds for large gaps, but kind of the state-of-the-art method uses moments of the zeta function, and this was originally developed by Richard Roxby Hall in 1999. And one thing that's really nice about this method, besides the fact that it produces superior large gap results, that is unconditional. So it doesn't assume the Riemann hypothesis. And the reason why it doesn't assume the Riemann hypothesis, the way you can get around that, is that we kind of start the problem over and we say, well, we're just going to look at the zeros that are already on the critical line. All right. So instead of looking at the whole sequence of all the ordinates of the zeros of the zeta function, we're going to say, well, I already know that there are at least 41% of the zeros are on the half line. This is a result of Connery and Bowie and Young. And so maybe if I just look at the analysis on those, if I get big gaps between those, then that'll tell me about the big gaps for all of them. So instead of using a little lambda that we used before for this, the lim sup over all the consecutive zeros, we're going to use a capital lambda. And again, we're just restricting to zeros that already live on the half line. All right, so we already know that because we're looking at a smaller set, this capital lambda is always going to be at least as big as little lambda. And remember from Selberg, we know this is greater than one. All right, so where are we? Remember that the conjecture is that we should be able to get to infinity. All right, and we are far away from that. So Hall's result in 99 using this method obtained a lower bound of 2.26 on lambda. And the current record is the record that's given by Bowie and Milinovich of a lower bound of 3.18. If you want to compare to the results of the Mueller method, then under the Riemann hypothesis, the best you can get that's done so far is 2.9. And if you assume more, like the generalized Riemann hypothesis for Dirichlet L functions, then Feng and Wu have improved this a bit. But still, the numerically superior result is due to Hall's method. So what I'd like to do is show you what Hall's method is, and then it reveals the relationship to the conjectures on the moments of the zeta function. And so Hall's method is based off of, and it's something, an inequality that you might have seen in like a real analysis class called Verdinger's inequality. So the way this is usually stated in books is that if f is a real continuously differentiable function that vanishes, at zero and pi, then you get this inequality between the function, the mean value of the function, and of its derivative. So you can extend this. So you can do a change of variable and also extend it to complex valued continuously differentiable functions to get the following inequality. And so what I'd like to just point out is that if a and b are zeros of the function, then because of the change of variable, what comes out here is b minus a. And so that's a gap between zeros of whatever function you have. And so in particular, if you're able to calculate this mean value of the absolute value or the modulus of f, and this mean value of the modulus of the derivative, well, then you're going to have a lower bound on gaps. And that's basically the idea of what we've got going on here. So what I'm going to do, due to time, I had a little toy example prepared. But I'm going to skip that to kind of get to the point of what this has to do with the mean values that we can do. All right, so In the case of Verdinger's inequality, we have to be able to calculate mean values of whatever our choice of f is and its derivative. That's essentially the big piece of the puzzle that's going on here. Now, Hall made a decision to choose the Hardy Z function, which is a real analog of the Riemann zeta function, in his 1999 paper. And he was able to do this because the fourth moment of the Hardy Z function is known. This moment was done by Ingham. And the fourth moment of the derivative is something that Hall worked out for this paper. All right, so it really hinges on, can you do these mean values or not? Now, there have been some modifications to this method. So just like in our previous method, you have a lot of choice. You can choose what type of function you want to choose, what function you want to work with. And Hall in 2005 realized that if you add in some shifts into the argument, and small shifts about size 1 over log t, then you can actually win a little bit more. And it's not, adding the shift is not for a smoothing idea. It actually just pulls out a little, it actually will give you a little bit longer of an interval. All right, so the idea is like maybe I can use shifts, and if I can do those mean values, then I'm good to go. So the current record, due to Bowie and Milinovich, of this 3.18 incorporates the shifts and also incorporates an idea of one of the other authors that I cited, where we can actually work with a complex valued function. And so the thing to point out here is in this really big choice of f, this here helps you, the function, mimic a real valued function. So the idea is it's helping you mimic, say, the Hardy Z function. What's really important here is that you have two products of zeta. And the reason why we can do this is because we know the relevant mean value theorems. But then we also have some sort of amplifier that is multiplied on. And the idea of the amplifier is supposed to help compensate for the fact that we are kind of restricted with what moments that we can calculate. So this m here, this is just a Dirichlet polynomial that's meant to get really big around zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And you might say, well, that could introduce new zeros into the mix. Well, if it does, that's fine. It just means you don't get as good of an upper bound or lower bound on the large gaps, all right? So the different choices of amplifiers and how long you can make them has been another big source of ways to contribute to getting better records. So what I'll end with is the limitations of this method. So as we've said before, the method relies on being able to compute these mean values. And for zeta, we only have this information for the second and the fourth moment. And that's why these amplifiers are being explored. The longer the length, the better we do. It helps you approximate higher moments of the zeta function. So what we think in terms of, so here's our last conjecture. What do we think about moments of the zeta function? Well, here's the folklore conjecture. The second moment and the fourth moment were proved by Hardy and Littlewood in 1918, and then Ingham in 1926. And then precise values for C of K have been conjectured by a host of different number theorists from different points of view. If you see the name, so here we have Connery Ghosh and Connery and Gonick. This was using number theoretic techniques. Keating and Snaith have made precise conjectures for what these C sub K should be using random matrix theory. Diaconu, Goldfeld, and Hofstein have done this using multiple Dirichlet series. And then there's an L functions recipe paper by Connery, Farmer, Keating, Rubinstein, and Snaith that also gives precise conjectures for these C sub Ks. So you might say, well, if I just assume I know all the moments, how good can I get? This has been worked out in a couple of different scenarios, but not since Hall realized how good it was to put in shifts. So in 2002, Hall worked out if you knew certain moments of the Hardy Z function, you could get certain results for lambda. But this was before he realized that adding in shifts would get you something a little bit better. So I think a way to go forward in this is you could say, well, let me look up the recipe for moments of L functions by Connery, Farmer, Keating, Rubinstein, and Snaith. these and tell you what the moment should be with all the shifts worked out. So the shifts are already in there. And I think it would be interesting to see what the recipe might yield. And maybe you could harness some knowledge on the other hand of just the second and the fourth moment together to get a reveal. But right now, it's not even been worked out how good you could get if you knew all these shifted moments. And so there's something that maybe if someone's interested in then in this, let me know. I can point you towards the relevant papers and you can see what you can do. Okay, so I will stop there. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions? Well, let me start with a question. Do you believe these conjectures about the small gaps between zeros and the large gaps? Because it seems like you were saying this one-half barrier seems pretty difficult.
Yeah, I think the one-half barrier is difficult because it's really, really hard to prove that there aren't any Landau-Ziegler zeros. And I don't believe that there are Landau-Ziegler zeros. So I think that it's hard because it's related to this very deep problem about exceptional zeros of different L functions. But I don't think that means it's impossible. I just think that that means that the reason why these you see these new results coming out and you've chipped away a little bit at the half is really coming from the small gaps results. Now, for the large gap results, you don't have that kind of interpretation like you do for the small gaps. And so it's not clear to me how, like, what the barrier of the limit is. On the other hand, I find it really convincing that the spacings of the zeros of the zeta functions are the zeros are behaving like eigenvalues of random Hermitian matrices. There's so much numerical evidence to support that, which again, doesn't mean it's for sure, but it's such a strong connection that I feel like it must be true for all of the different reasons that would say it's true. But I just think they're hard problems, and so we're really far off from getting to where we want to be.
Thank you. And let's see, other questions?
Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hi. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. I can't see anything, but I can hear you just fine.
Okay, can you see me now?
My screen, for some reason, is completely frozen, but I can hear you just fine.
Yeah, it's fine. You mentioned the Henry-Iwaniak 2000 constant, 2002 constant, as being less than or equal to one half.
So the Conry-Iwaniak's paper, what that shows is that if you could get less than a half, then you can conclude that there aren't any Landau-Ziegler zeros. But nobody's been able to prove that if part of the hypothesis.
Is the constant the entire ratio or just gamma?
So what you need to prove is less than a half is the difference between the so you've got the coordinate, the ordinance of the zeros here, so that's a space, and then you divide out by the average spacing. And what we want to show is that this is less than, more or less than a half for lots and lots of zeros, so greater than t log t to the 4/5. So if you want to think about this in terms of the mu function, I'm saying I want mu to be less than a half unconditionally very, very often. And all the results that I've talked about today hold for infinitely many zeros.
For all values of n?
Nope, not for all values. Yeah, so you're going to have some different spacings that are going on, but like in the limit, as n goes to infinity, you want mu to be less than a half. For example, the earlier results of a positive proportion of zeros satisfying these bounds, that would be more than sufficient to satisfy Conry-Iwaniak's. But again, we have to not assume the Riemann hypothesis. And where we are right now, if you want unconditional and lots of zeros, we just know that mu is less than one. That's the standard result.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome.
Let's see, other questions?
I have a question here. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, yeah, this is Daniel Haas from Boston University. My question is there any upper bound known on how good of lower bounds on lambda Hall's method can give analogous to this result for that one method, and I forget who it was attributed to, but for the lower bounds, or for the small gap, saying, you know, this method can't give better than 1/2. So is there anything
right.
similar for upper bounds?
So there hasn't, so, okay, so the literature here is a little, so let me pull this up. So let me tell you what's known and where this kind of falls apart. So sorry, I'm kind of doing this very quickly. So the only work that has been done to show you, for example, if you were to go ahead and assume all of the moments, are some work that was done in early 2000 by Hall. But this was when he was still thinking about putting in real valued functions into Verdinger's inequality. So he was thinking about the Hardy Z function, and he was assuming some moments for those and showing what values you could get, excuse me, I didn't even write this here, on lower bounds on lambda. No one has written down, as far as I know, no one has written down how good this method would do if you use all the shifts and you incorporate the Connery, Farmer, Keating, Rubinstein, and Snaith moments results. That hasn't been worked out. So at the end of Hall's paper, for example, I'm not aware of any calculation that says, but we're never going to get bigger than a certain number here. At least in the sense of using the Hardy Z function. So we don't have some sort of nice precise statement like we do in the Connery Goshen-Gonick paper.
Great, let's see, any other questions? Well, I want to thank everybody for coming here today, and also Caroline, thank you for a wonderful talk.
Thank
so
you.
Let's thank Caroline again. And we'll meet again in 2 weeks.
All right, thank you.